I am challenged and blessed by serving as this city's demographer. There are very few other markets or cities that I would rather be working in. I'm from Austin, so I feel blessed that I get to do what I do in my hometown. Austin's demographic story really, to my mind, revolves around three primary themes. The first one is probably the easiest to document and to talk about, and that's long-term, sustained, rapid population growth. We see it every day. We feel it every day. And it's something that I think is very important to the discussion of diversity. The second theme is diversity itself. I think that we have experienced profound diversification. Now, certainly as a demographer, I focus on racial and ethnic diversification, and a lot of the data that I brought today will shore that up. But I think it goes well beyond racial and ethnic diversification. It's economic. It's socioeconomic. It's cultural. It's amazing how less of a homogeneous community we are today than we were when I was growing up here in the 60s. And I think that this diversity is very much a big-time economic development engine for us. I think it's one of the reasons why we continue to grow. When you look out at the set of big cities in this country, cities that diversified during the aughts grew. Cities that did not diversify didn't grow at all. In fact, many of them lost population. So I think that diversity in all of its, you know, and Jason, I appreciate the fact it's a difficult term to really define and nail down. But I see it as an extreme positive. And I even think that we can use an analogy from the environmental sciences to where you can look at a rainforest. It has a greater degree of biodiversity than any other ecosystem on the planet. And if you can maintain that diversity, that leads to sustainability. And so that, to me, is a big part of it. And yet, I am also compelled to ask the question, are we as diverse as we think we are? Are we as inclusive as we could be? And to take a quote from a local economist, a colleague of Hakanyos, who I've heard is going to be here at some point, John Roberts, he says it this way, and it's a mouthful, so hear me now and think about it later. A city's level of sustainability is in direct proportion to its ability to integrate its diversity. So yes, diversity is a positive, but if we don't integrate this diversity, then we're not really taking advantage of it. And that, to me, segues to the third big theme that I think Austin, and there are a couple of ways we can say this, and I'm not trying to equivocate, we're at risk, we've become a more divided community. Because as we've grown so rapidly and as we've diversified so profoundly, the spatial manifestation of who lives where and how that landscape sorts itself out, I think that there are some serious divisions that we need to pay attention to. So those are the three themes my slides will cover. I'll move through those. I don't have a clicker, so we're going to do this old school, and I'll say next. There is, as promised, long-term sustained rapid population growth. Next. And one more just to show that we are the 13th most populous city in the country. This graphic, I think, surprises a lot of people. This is not spatial size, but this is people. And it's interesting to think about how we have rapidly climbed up this ladder. In 1990, we were the 27th largest city in the country. By 2000, we had become the 16th largest. Census 2010 pegged us at the 14th largest. New information from the Bureau puts us at 13th. I actually think we are now 11th. We have passed Indianapolis and passed Jacksonville. We're simply growing at a faster rate than those cities. We won't have verification of this until May when the Census Bureau releases new data. We'll stay in the 11th position for a few years because right ahead of us will be San Jose. They've got about 950,000. Ultimately, we will pass them, but that won't be for a couple of years. Next. And one more click to show that we were the 6th fastest growing city in absolute terms, not percent terms, because by percent terms we'd move up that list. But to me, this is pretty amazing that for a city our size, in absolute terms, we were the sixth fastest growing. You can also see down at the bottom of the list, Detroit and Chicago. You know, what a world apart. Detroit hemorrhaged 250,000 people during the aughts. And the changes that have occurred in Detroit are significant. Our problems, of course, lie at the other end of the continuum, and that's managing the growth and managing the diversity. Next. Also, at the new information from the Census Bureau pushes us into the actual fastest growing position. This is large cities. I define large as any city that has more than 500,000 people. Not only are we the fastest growing city, but you can see that we're significantly faster than numbers 2, 3, and 4. Next. And also the MSA. Jason makes the point that we're the city, but I think we also have to challenge ourselves to look at us as a community, because that jurisdictional line, while it's important to us at the city, the organic creature that is Austin, I would argue, is metropolitan Austin. The city's a huge, huge part of it. I think that's, you know, why we continue to be successful as a city. But it really is at the metropolitan level. Also notice on that list, every city, every large urban area in Texas is in that top 10. And I think that's telling. Next. This is a map of metropolitan Austin, the five-county collection of Williamson, Travis, Bastrop, Hayes, Caldwell, defined as our commuting shed. In 1990, Bastrop and Caldwell were not part of that. As those counties suburbanized, as they grew, as they sent commuters into the central city, they became included in the MSA. We expect someday the inclusion of Burnett and Blanco counties to our west and northwest. We're contiguous to the San Antonio metropolitan area, Comal and Guadalupe counties. Next. And one more. That's a set of the 10 fastest growing cities. And again, look at the Texas cluster, Denver, Oklahoma City. New Orleans makes the list because they're still repopulating after Katrina. And then also North Carolina and Northern Virginia, of course, on the top of that list. Next. And I think three clicks to show, maybe one more, you'll get three arrows. This is intended to drive home the point that right now we are receiving a large stream of incoming households. Many of them are what I would call economic migrants. They may not have a job lined up in Texas, but their job prospects are far better in Texas than they are in still the economically devastated sections of California, Florida. I mean, who would have ever thought that Florida would depopulate? I mean, they 3 years ago, they experienced net population loss. I never would have predicted that. Of course, Florida got hammered by the housing bubble in the same way that Las Vegas and Reno and those places. And, of course, we continue to receive in-migrants from the Midwest. Next. This is the big reason why we're attracting these migrants. Texas and Austin and all metropolitan areas in Texas are creating jobs, right? Certainly quality of life is a big part of our growth story, but without job creation, you wouldn't have this big, big influx of individuals. We're out on the right-hand side of that graphic. To me, what's significant is that we created 35,000 jobs last year. I think we also have to pause and ask ourselves, are these the kind of jobs that we want to be creating? In general, and this is, I think, something the panel will get into later, we're creating lots of jobs on both ends, but maybe not as many jobs as we'd like to be creating in the middle, in terms of middle skill, middle education level, and I think that's a challenge for us as a community. Next. Another way to sort of drive home where we're receiving our migrants from, Kelso over at the Statesman loves to talk about the Californians and how they're changing our economy and lifestyle. But it's really in total terms we receive more migrants from the other big Texas urban areas, Houston, Dallas, and San Antonio. And yet certainly on that list you see Los Angeles and Chicago and Phoenix and New York. And I think that's amazing. Next. An important piece to keep in mind, again, back to Jason's point about it's not just the city, but it's the metropolitan area. During the aughts, the lion's share of our population growth occurred outside the city. Now, that's not to say that the city itself didn't grow, as we've shown, one of the fastest growing cities in the country, but I think this is a reality that we need to continue to deal with as we realize that probably most of our growth will continue to come outside the city. And yet, I'm quick to say that Austin has done a very, very good job of attracting households, of investing in the urban core. And I think that our vibrant downtown is certainly one of the reasons why Austin has not followed a hollowing out pattern like so many other American cities have. Next. A simple way to sort of drive that home is that back in 1960, the city of Austin was the lion's share of the region's population at 65%. That has dropped below 50%. It will continue to drop. Next. Next. So point two, thank you, profound racial and ethnic diversification. Next. This graph shows the growth for the city of Austin between 2000 and 2010, and it deals it out by racial and ethnic category. And the really two things to point out here, that the bulk of our growth came from growth within the Hispanic community. That has been the dominant story. Locally, it's been the dominant story in Texas and in other parts of the country. But also, I think it's something that we need to deal with in a very forthright way. We experienced a loss in absolute terms in our African-American population. This really surprised me as a practicing demographer. We've been watching our African-American share of total at the city, right? Not MSA level, but at the city level, decline slowly over time. This fabulous facility that we're in today, right? It's in the heart of what was a very, very dense urban enclave. I mean, go back to 1970 when 80% of Travis County's population lived in basically this greater neighborhood. And so there's been a high level of suburbanization, desegregation. There are a couple of different terms you can use, but I think that we need to be very forthright when we deal with this. I think that that trend has changed. I think that when whoever is in this position and shows this graph to our counterparts 7 or 8 years from now, I think that you'll see growth at the city level. Next. But at the MSA level, you can see that there was indeed growth in the African-American population. And so, to me, this phenomenon is more jurisdictional. It has to do with suburbanization patterns, which, by the way, occurred in almost every city in the country. It happened in Washington, D.C. It happened in Atlanta, Los Angeles. This is not a unique pattern to us by any means. But you can also see, even at the metropolitan level, growth from the Hispanic community outnumbered growth in the non-Hispanic white community. That's the first time that's ever happened. Next. Now, to take the sort of long sweep of history, I want to go back to 1960 when, as a city, we were overwhelmingly non-Hispanic Anglo. 72-73% of the city's population was non-Hispanic white. And two relatively same-sized, you can see that the African-American and the Hispanic population down there, orange and blue bar, relatively similar, sitting at about 12, 13, 14%, and an almost non-existent share of total coming to us from the Asian community. As we march over time, we find ourselves in 2010, where all of a sudden you notice not a single bar is above 50%. So we've joined every other large North American city in becoming a so-called majority minority city. Now that's an interesting term, and I think recently it has gained maybe a pejorative rating. I don't know. I mean, there's the argument that even that term is a little bit, you know, why are we still talking about this notion of majority minority? But I think it's important to sort of see that in next, you'll see that if you take that and project it forward in the next 7 years and the next 17 years, a couple of things happen. We will have possibly more individuals of Hispanic origin within the city than any other group. And you also see that the African-American share of total and the Asian share of total change places. Another way to put it, maybe more straightforward, is that we'll have more individuals of Asian descent within the city of Austin than African-American individuals. That will be a watershed event because of our history, because of where we've come and how we've changed. Next. In a simple way to sort of compare the city to the MSA, the city and the MSA are tracking along a very similar trajectory, but the MSA is about 6 percentage points behind, but it will only be a matter of time, I think, before the metropolitan area then begins to mimic the ethnicity and racial shares of the city. Next. An important point to talk about, because this has changed. This is a pie chart that shows the components of growth, really. Unless you arrive here by spaceship, there are only three components of growth. Natural increase, right? Births over deaths. domestic migration, households moving here from other parts of the state and other parts of the country, and international immigration, households moving here from outside the country. Interestingly enough, this flow, which was not entirely, but it was mainly from Latin America, has stopped at about zero. And there are push and pull factors behind migration. One of the factors that I think a lot of demographers and economists talk about is that the birth rate in Mexico in 1965, the birth rate was 6.2 children per female. That has dropped to 2.1. That's a game changer. That's a big, big difference. The same dropping, falling birth rate has occurred within our own domestic Latino population. And so while I'm not saying that we won't continue to receive some of our growth from international immigration, for the time being, it is really that spigot has been turned off, and I think that that is significant. Next. One more. Spatial divisions are more distinct. That's, again, my sort of, you know, equivocating way of saying the lines are becoming more harder. The divisions are becoming larger. Not in every case, but I think that this is an issue that is a result of our rapid growth. It's a result of our diversification. And I think it's a challenge for us as a community going forward is how do we integrate this diversity? Next. One way to show this, 2000 data on the left, Census 2010 data on the right. You can see I-35 going up the middle. Let me just use an example. Look at the greater Quail Creek area, the neighborhoods around what many of us will know as Lanier High School. A quintile color ramp where it goes 20, 40, 60, 80%. Look at the red and purple census blocks. Those are census blocks that have at least 60% Hispanic population or 80%. Simply put, look how many more red and purple census blocks you have in this area. Now, I want to point out that, yes, that's a result of diversification, but within those neighborhoods, you've actually had an increase in the homogeneity of the neighborhood. And so those neighborhoods really sort of serve a dual function. They're places for incoming families to sort of live within an envelope of language. These are predominantly Spanish-speaking neighborhoods. They're 90 to 95% Latino, multi-generational households. And so they are accommodating neighborhoods, but the flip to that is that they're also potentially isolating mechanisms. When you have that kind of homogeneity within a neighborhood, you begin to have challenges. AISD has got a program called Pierce the Bubble. And what they're talking about is the bubble of linguistic isolation that can occur from this type of settlement pattern. Next. This is median family income by census tract. It's new data from the American Community Survey. And a couple of things worth pointing out. Again, we're at the MSA level. You still see, undoubtedly, a very steep east to west gradient. But you also begin to see, they're scared I'm going to hit them with a laser. And yet you really do begin to see some changes. I don't know if you guys can see this, but this is the redeveloping, I guess I'm going to give it up and start calling it Miller. We always called it Mueller. I'm outnumbered. I'll call it Miller. That's an area that's changing. Core East Austin is changing. You begin to see little points that are outside that sort of traditional dark blue. Over the sweep of history, that concentration of affluent households has slowly but surely marched out of the city and into the Western Hills. And that changes the landscape of what it means to live here. This map is really a very different kind of collection than some of our peer metropolitan areas. It's different than Denver. It's different than Houston. They don't have quite such a concentration where basically one large area contains all of the affluent households. But again, this is beginning to change, and I think it's this is particularly why I like this map, because it's new data, and it says to me that we're beginning to make some progress on breaking down that very, very sort of island effect that you see. Next. One of the things, and this is something that ACM Snipes and others, we dealt with the a city manager's what he called an advance on affordable housing, and it was a fascinating conversation. City manager challenged us to have a candid conversation, and I think we did manage to have a candid conversation. This is a map of Section 8 housing units. Section 8, simply put, is one of the few avenues that we have to provide subsidized affordable housing. My point here is that the concentrations that you see in places like Dove Springs and Moore's Crossing and Austin's Colony, I was just having a conversation with Shannon Jones about Austin's Colony, these concentrations vigorously support that pattern of socioeconomic difference. They vigorously support that gradient. Now, it's one thing to talk about, yes, let's try and deconcentrate that. How do you do it? That's a difficult thing. But I think that as a community, we have got to figure out a way to where we don't put all of our affordable subsidized housing in this basic one Eastern Crescent, because this drives other sociological phenomena. Next. This is a map of single mother-headed households. I'm not showing this as any sort of, I'm not trying to make an ethical statement. I'm not trying to make, it's not a Murphy Brown moment, but it's for me to point out that children in these households are at a great economic disadvantage compared to children in households where both parents are present, right? That's the blinding flash, the obvious. But I use this because this pattern, right, it's the pattern that's being reinforced by that Section 8 pattern. And so that income map is always going to look like it does unless we can do something about these concentrations. I appreciate the heads nodding there on the front row. Next. And finally, something that's right now and it's happening, age structure is changing dramatically. Next. This is our simplified population pyramid at the MSA level. I put both genders together, and you can still see that we're dominated by college and post-college age cohorts, but that's changing in a big, big way. Next. This shows how, our concentration at the Austin MSA level, these are percentages from the cohorts. That's the nation as a whole in that dark blue and that purple. And you can see this really does set us apart. But take a look right there. That's what's beginning to change. You can't quite see it yet, but we're also seeing a big, big increase in our seniors. Next. Those were the collections of cities. In fact, Austin was the second fastest growing MSA in the country in terms of its percentage increase in seniors. Now, truth in advertising, we still have a relatively small share of total that are seniors. But that attraction of seniors, I think, portends a change in what it means to retire. I think that retirees, that whole dynamic is changing. People are choosing Austin because of our vibrancy, because of our cultural vitality. It's no longer let's go out to a fortress on the desert in a Sun City model. They want to be next to libraries, universities, cultural amenities, next to grandchildren, right? And so I think that Austin is going to continue to receive an increasing flow of seniors. And one more, next. We were the fastest growing MSA in the country when it came to pre-seniors. And Howard will know this he'll rather call that a leading edge baby boomer. But I love the term pre-senior. Because, right, I'm a trailing edge baby boomer. My managers have always been leading edge baby boomers. And I can't wait for them to retire, but they're never going to. So, next. This is a way to show the kind of growth I'm talking about. This is our age structure in 2000 turned on our side. This is the age structure in 2010. This is our normal part of expansion, right? College and post-college. And again, I think this is where Hawk and Yost would agree with me that, you know, this is still what makes Austin so attractive because we're attracting college grads and post-college grads. But this is something that's very, very significant. 75% of this expansion in these very young cohorts came from our Latino population. Again, I keep using the term challenges and going forward, but I think that that's part of my job. We're in a state that's defunding public education at the very time that we should be dialing it up. I don't see how we can make an argument that we're going to sustain, or as Pike Powers puts it, stay on the horse, if we don't educate and integrate and bring these folks into our society. And then also, this is the expansion I like to call a thickening in the middle, and that's the expansion of seniors and baby boomers. Next. And then do two clicks for me, and we'll get the animation out of the way. And one more. Simply to back up, sorry about that, it's a little touchy, is that currently, you know, granted, only 8% of our population is 65-plus, but look what happens in a very, very short 27, 25 years. That 8% climbs to 18%. And you do that in a metropolitan area that's growing like crazy, and all of a sudden you have a big, big increase. You go from 140 to 700,000 seniors. And there's also going to be diversification of this cohort. It's not simply growth. Next. Currently, when you look at individuals, a way to compare the Austin MSA race and ethnicity to that race and ethnicity of seniors, overwhelmingly, most of our seniors today are non-Hispanic Anglo. Next. But in 30 years, that changes dramatically to where we have that sort of evening out. And that will be a very different set of challenges from a healthcare standpoint, a social policy standpoint, and a housing standpoint. Next. Next. If we talk about growth and diversification, we absolutely have to talk about what I call the Asian boom. Next. In percentage terms, not absolute terms, but in percentage terms, you can see that the Asian community was by far and away the fastest growing group. Next. And one more click. Our regional population is doubling every 20 years. Our Asian population is doubling almost every 10 years. Really, really rapid growth. One more. One more. Currently, we have the 10th largest share of total in the country at the city level. We probably won't maybe ever get up to the San Francisco or San Jose level, but I think that we're already probably past Philly and Portland. And that really does set Austin apart. Most southern cities have sort of a black-white dichotomy. Southwestern cities have an Anglo-Hispanic dichotomy. But Austin has got these four significant racial and ethnic groups. And to me, it gives us more of what I would call a coastal profile. It really does set us apart. We have the highest share of total of any Texas city, not in absolute terms, because Houston has got such a huge, huge population. But I think this is significant, and it will continue to be important. Next. And what I sort of call diversity within diversity, if you were Asian and in Austin 40 years ago, more than likely you were Chinese and associated with the University of Texas. That's not the case today. The fastest growing subcomponent has been the Indian Asian component. That's interesting. And of course, a large component from Vietnamese and Chinese. Next. And that's a way to sort of, these are census blocks, and I've taken the color ramp and stopped it at 15%. But you can see this sort of suburban arcing residential pattern with heavy concentration in the north. These are neighborhoods, Great Hills and Spicewood. Not entirely, but these are heavily concentrated with Asian Indian households. And in the northeast, you see concentration of Vietnamese households. And again, maybe I'm outing myself as a data nerd, but I think it's fascinating the way you can see these patterns using the census data. Next. And I think I'd like to provocatively close with, we may be in for something that we're not quite used to, and that's political diversification. And again, I'm going to maybe step out on some thin ice, but here goes. Next. That map, I still can't get over. It was the map from Prop 3, right? The fact that we as a city chose to reject the status quo. So the color ramp, if it's red or orange, they voted against Prop 3. They wanted to keep the city at large. We're currently the largest city in the country, the largest city that still elects its council at large. And of course, that's about to change. And I think for those of us who work for the city, we're still kind of trying to get our brain around what that's going to mean. I think it's going to mean a very, very different set of parameters, maybe, to use and to smooth over that. But amazingly, the only part of town that voted to keep the status quo was the very part of town that was enjoying the hegemony or the benefit of that virtual single-member district. So what do I mean by political diversification? I mean that we're probably going to have councilmen and women coming from parts of town. They may run on a platform of, I'm going down to City Hall to change the way we do business. It's going to be a potentially a very different type of thing. For good or for ill, I think Ed Van Eno said it best, but we're going to be the folks that are going to get to shepherd in this new day. So I bring this up because I think diversification goes well beyond simply race and ethnicity. It's socioeconomic. It's political. It's in so many ways. We're so blessed in Austin to have this as a challenge because so many communities would love to have this as a challenge. They would do anything they could to be growing and diversifying like we are. So I think that may be my last slide. It is. Thank you very much.